getting started with PyTorch. PyTorch is a very widely used deep learning library, and in this video, we'll install PyTorch, talk about some basic data structures, train our very first model, use the model to perform inference, and learn about how to save and load models that you've already created. By the end of this video, you should feel like you have a solid foundation with PyTorch. All of the code from this video is also available in a Jupyter notebook on GitHub. Installation. This part should be pretty easy. Just clone this repo and cd into the folder shown here, open it up in VS Code, and of course be sure to create a virtual environment and activate it. Then you can just pip install torch and matplotlib and you should be ready to go. Here's what it should look like when you're done. So before we get into anything too serious, we're going to do some simple stuff with just some data structures that might not be familiar to you yet, but they're essential to knowing how to use PyTorch. The main structure is a tensor, which you'll see soon. So we'll import some things, create some tensors, do some operations with them. We'll talk about automatic differentiation and moving tensors to the GPU. Here, we're just importing PyTorch and printing out the version, very simple. Next, we'll create a tensor. So the tensor is the basic unit in TensorFlow. So we can create a one-dimensional tensor, also known as a vector. You'll see that there. And we can create a 2D tensor or a matrix. When we run it, it looks like this. For the vector, you can do element-wise addition or subtraction, where you add or multiply each element by some number. For the matrix, you can do matrix multiplication. You'll remember from linear algebra, not too fun to do by hand, but Torch will take care of it for you in an instant. Now let's talk about automatic differentiation. Think about this equation. It's a quadratic equation, x squared plus 3x plus 1. Do a little calculus, move the 2 down, throw away the constant, all that stuff, you get the derivative. Now, if we pass in x equals 2 into our original equation, we can figure out by hand the value of the function at that point, and from the derivative, the slope of the line at that point. What is it doing? What is the gradient? Is it going up or down? In Torch, we'll set requires grade to true so that it keeps track of necessary things as it does computations with the tensor. Then, if we use the tensor in a computation that matches the original equation, we can call y.backward to compute all of the gradients, which sets the x.grad field. So if we check that, we see that the values that we get out are equal to our hand-computed values. So when things get complicated, you can skip the calculus and just use Torch. Finally, to move a tensor to the GPU, you have to check if CUDA is available, and if it is, you just call .2CUDA, and you're good to go. Unfortunately, I do not have such a GPU, and I'm pretty sad about it. All you get to see is, on my end, GPU not available. Now let's do something real. We're going to train a model. First, we'll create an example dataset, then we'll define a linear model. This probably looks familiar from algebra class. The only difference is we're using W, or weight, for the coefficient of X, and B, or bias, for the y-intercept. So we'll train the model that we defined using training data, in air quotes, it's really just the exact values, and the model, we will see, adjusts W and B to minimize a loss function. Once we have the model, we'll use it to perform inference on arbitrary X values. So just like before, we'll do some imports to get started here, and then we'll create an example dataset. Here we're just plugging in hard-coded values. We've evaluated 2x plus 1 at x equals 1, 2, 3, and 4, and put those values into the y variable there. If we plot the data, this is what we get. Definitely nothing earth-shattering here. Next, let's define a linear model. This is built into PyTorch. We have one input feature and one output feature, because each point only has one x value, and then the output is one y value. It's not multidimensional. Next, we'll define a loss function. We'll use mean squared error, which is common for regression problems such as this one. And finally, we'll define our optimizer, which uses stochastic gradient descent, which is outside the scope of this video. Next, we'll train the model. We'll define 1000 for the number of epochs, or number of times that we go through the data and run it. And each time we do, we will plug in values to the model, compute the loss, we'll save the loss value so we can plot it on the next slide, and then we'll zero gradients, perform a backward pass, and update the weights. If this doesn't sound familiar, check out the notebook because there are some more detailed descriptions in there. And as you can see from the output, the loss function gets very, very close to zero at the end. Now let's perform inference. When we're doing inference, we don't need to keep track of gradients, so we use no grad to turn that off and save processing power. And now we can plug any x value we want into the model and get something out. As you can see, we get 10.9, which is very close to the actual value of x equals 5 for 2x plus 1, which is 11. Now let's plug in the entire X domain from our training data and see what it looks like. Look closely and you'll see a little tiny bit of blue poking out. Generally speaking, we did pretty good because they're so close, it's really hard to tell the difference between the two. Next, let's plot our loss. As you can see, the loss starts very high. The model is off by a ton when we start out, but it very quickly hones in and finds a very close approximation for weight and bias. As you can see from the output, we start off being off by 26, then 18, then 12, then 8, and then we get towards the end, it's almost zero. So we have a trained model. What do we do with it? We may want to save it so we can use it somewhere else later. For this, we can just save the model state, which would include weights and biases. Apparently, this is preferred because it's flexible and portable. It's common when deploying to production or sharing with other people. The only downside is it doesn't include the code to redefine the model architecture. In our case, that was just defining the linear model, so not a big deal. The other option is to save the entire model, including its architecture. This is easy to use and avoids any error that might occur from reinstantiating all of the architecture components. It can be used for experimenting and prototyping, but probably a little cumbersome to use in production. So let's move on, and keep in mind our model is 2x plus 1. We can call torch.save on the state dict and save it to a PTH, which stands for PyTorch file. Then to use the model file, we have to redefine our architecture, and we'll plug in the state just to show how bad it is before we apply our weights and biases. Then we call loadStateDict on that file. We call eval, and then we can plug in the values again, and we see that they're accurate to 2x plus 1. So our trained model has been loaded from a file. Loading and saving the entire model is easier. You just call torch.save, and then you can call torch.load. That's about it. Still have to call eval, and then we can plug in our data again and see all of those function values look good for 2x plus 1 as well. So that's all I have for this video. I hope this was helpful to you. If you enjoyed, consider liking and subscribing for more things like this. Thanks.